In this video, we will talk about quantum machine learning and how we can use it in real-world applications. So let's see an example. Here's a ship traveling close to the coast. To do that safely, we have to know how deep the water is. There are methods to measure the water depth, but they can be quite time-consuming and expensive, so we need a more scalable approach. One option is to use some of the satellites that are orbiting our planet. Here's how a satellite captures sunlight reflected off different patches of the Earth's surface. There are many types of Earth observation satellites, but there's one type in particular that carries a so-called multispectral instrument, which is able to split up the reflected light into specific wavelength ranges across the electromagnetic spectrum, including infrared. The resulting data is an image of the Earth, where each pixel covers a small square on the Earth. And each pixel consists of multiple brightness values, namely one value per wavelength range. But how do these images relate to the depth of the sea? We need to find something that can connect both entities, something that takes all of these images and outputs depth values. One option to do this is by using neural networks, so let's see how this works. This is an image we got from the satellite. Like we learned before, it consists of brightness values along different wavelengths. Luckily, we're in an area where we already know the water depth. So what we can do now is use these pixels together with their depth values to train a neural network. On the left, you can see one pixel split up into its different wavelength. That's the input for the neural network. On the right is our target value, the 5-meter depth. So let's put a neural network in between and let's train its parameters by trying to fit it to all the different pixels with their respective depth from our satellite image. Perfect! We have a model that can relate satellite images to water depth. Now we can move away to a different area of the sea where we don't know the depth yet, and use this model to predict the depth of the water from the satellite image. The calculations involved to train neural networks, and for machine learning in general, can sometimes require multiple servers and large numbers of processing units. So we were wondering, is it possible to do these calculations in a different way in the future? To get better results in a faster way, while using less resources to reduce the impact on our environment? This is where a quantum computer could step in. A quantum computer is a device which tries to exploit phenomena from quantum mechanics, like superposition and entanglement, to ultimately do calculations. But how does that differ from a classical computer? The main difference is the underlying information system. Quantum information is namely not described by bits, which can be 0 or 1, but rather by qubits, which can be anything on the sphere around 0 and 1. This is what we call a superposition of 0 and 1, and if you now get the intuition that quantum information can be more powerful than classical information, you're right. There is a catch though. It is not possible to observe this vector on the sphere, because as soon as you try to measure a qubit, it collapses to either 0 or 1. And this collapse is not deterministic. The orientation of the vector gives the underlying probabilities of measuring 0 or 1. If the vector is closer to 0, it is more likely to measure 0. So if we have a lot of qubits that are all in this state, most of them will collapse pointing down, but some will point up. But remember, it's just the output that is binary again. During computation, we can still make use of the whole sphere. So we now have an idea about the different information system, resulting in a larger computational space. But we don't know yet what algorithms look like in this new system. What is commonly used to describe quantum algorithms is the so-called circuit model. Each wire represents one qubit. On the left, we denote the starting state of each qubit. Usually this is simply the zero state, so the arrow pointing straight up. And as we just learned, we cannot observe a qubit directly, we have to measure it. So on the right, we have measurement blocks for each qubit. We read a quantum circuit from left to right, so if we now want to do operations with our qubits, we can add so-called gates to the wires. These gates ultimately represent rotations of the vectors inside the spheres that represent our qubits. There are also gates that affect multiple qubits, and we can use such gates to create entanglement between two qubits. If we now run this circuit on a quantum computer, what will be the outcome? For each measurement, we get either a 0 or 1, so our output is a bit string. But as we learned earlier, a quantum computer is a probabilistic device. Measurements return a certain output only with a certain probability. So in practice, we run this circuit multiple times and count the amount of times we see each output. Usually we are then interested in the output with the most occurrences, but we could also consider the estimated underlying probabilities for the different bit strings. Nice! We understood how quantum information works and what a quantum circuit looks like. But let's rewind for a minute and remember where we started. We had satellite images that we want to use to predict the water depth. So let's look at one of those pixels and split it into the different wavelength. But now we just use the four most significant wavelengths and we build a quantum circuit, one qubit per wavelength. To make our qubits represent the respective values, we use this data embedding circuit, which basically encodes the brightness per wavelength onto the rotation of each qubit. Here you can already see an example of how powerful quantum information can be, because we can encode a floating point value into one single qubit. Now we add this blue block to the circuit. This block consists of parameterized gates, which, for now, somewhat arbitrarily modify the input data. You can think of this block as the quantum version of an initial structure for a neural network, with randomly initialized weights. So for now, we get a somewhat random result as the output of this circuit, which we can then translate to a water depth in meters. We can run this circuit now for a lot of different pixels, and for each pixel, we get a predicted water depth. But we only chose pixels where we also know the correct water depth, so we can keep track for how many pixels we got the correct result. This gives us sort of a metric of how good our model is performing, and clearly, with a randomly initialized circuit, we're doing pretty bad. So let us zoom into our blue circuit and start twisting and turning some dials to change the parameters. And then we can again check how the model performs. Did we now get more or less predictions correct? With the help of some smart classical methods to efficiently explore our options on how we can tweak the dials, we keep on testing different parameter sets until we find a good set for our model. Once we are happy with the parameters, we have a quantum circuit that can relate a pixel to the water depth. So we can again move to an area where we don't know the depth and use our quantum circuit to predict it. And why is it desirable to run those algorithms on quantum computers? Quantum computers are expected to be able to run certain algorithms a lot faster than classical computers. So instead of having to use all of these servers, we might just need one quantum computer. This could save a lot of resources and energy. Additionally, quantum computers might be able to train better performing machine learning models, while potentially needing less data to train on. And obtaining training data is generally a very expensive and human-intensive process. It is also quite interesting to note that for the described use case we only need 4 qubits. So the limitation here does not actually come from the amount of qubits necessary, but rather from the quality of those 4 qubits, as well as the quality of the necessary gate operations. So, we've seen how we can use quantum machine learning to estimate the water depth by using satellite images. And this can result in a more accurate and larger scale mapping of the seabed, which helps ships to optimize their routes to enable safe and sustainable travel. The work you've just seen is the result of a project from TNO together with S&T.